Greetings from CNS and welcome to this special episode of CNS Dialogues for Sustainable Development, a special CNS series presenting insightful and thought-provoking interviews from leaders to accelerate progress towards achieving Agenda 2030, where no one is left behind, including the children. Why am I talking of children? Well, we'll come to know soon about it. Today we have with us Francis Bompard, again I think I have pronounced his name incorrectly, who is Director of Pediatric HIV and HCV at the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative, DNDI. And we are on site from Africa's biggest conference on AIDS, ICASA 2019, the 20th International Conference on AIDS and Sexually Transmitted Infections in Africa, being held in Kigali, Rwanda. Welcome. Here. Francis, in 2018, 1.7 million children below 15 years of age were living with HIV. It's a huge number. And 160,000 of these were newly infected with the virus. To me, children are getting infected with HIV for no fault of theirs. And yet, they are one of the most neglected populations when it comes to diagnosis as well as treatment. Can you please share your thoughts on that?
Thank you, Shobha. First of all, thank you for inviting DNDI to speak to you today. So to answer your question, the reason why children, newborns, are neglected is because they are so few in numbers. You know, we have about nearly 40 million people living with HIV in the world. And as you said, 160,000 newborns are infected with HIV every year, which is a tiny little group of people. And the numbers are bound to become smaller and smaller as prevention of mother-to-child transmission improves. Prevention of mother-to-child transmission of the virus is very effective. It's very easy, but unfortunately, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, not all mothers are properly taken care of. So at DNDI, we focus on neglected populations. And so what we have identified are neglected children, those who are born with HIV. But very importantly, as you said yourself, those children have been infected by their mothers around the time of birth or right after birth, because their mothers were neglected. Their mothers were not properly taken care of initially. So for us, it's important to advocate for the children and also for the mothers to be properly treated.
Okay. I believe diagnosis of HIV is difficult in children as in adults. And the treatment protocols also. What are the current treatments which are being given to children with kids with HIV? Particularly in low and middle income countries?
Well, like all HIV treatments, you need to have a combination of drugs. So the most frequent combination includes four drugs, usually presented as three separate medicines. And the problem is that many progresses have been done to simplify the treatment of adults. Nowadays, adults can be treated with very easy to use, oftentimes once a day, fixed dose combination of several antiretroviral medicines. Unfortunately, no one has bothered about the babies because the babies represent such a small group of patients that they, to speak bluntly, they do not represent a market. And so this is why DNDI, which is dedicated to developing drugs for neglected diseases, neglected populations, drugs that would not exist because there is no market for them, has decided to get involved in this field. So nowadays, for children in many parts of Africa, what you need to do is to use a syrup, which includes two of these drugs, which is very, very foul tasting. Mm-hmm. Really, people who have tasted it say it's got a horrible taste and a long-lasting aftertaste, mm-hmm. which means that kids, you know, you can give that to them once or twice, but after that they refuse to take it, plus two other drugs. And so the syrup itself is very bad tasting. It's very bulky. It needs to be refrigerated. So the mothers have got to carry lots of bottles to treat their children, keep them in a refrigerator. It's, of course, a challenge in many parts of Africa. And it's also a challenge because the bottles are visible. So therefore, when the mothers need to dispose the bottles after usage, you know, the neighbors can see that somebody has got HIV in the family. And this is not a good thing. So stigma is very high in many parts of the world, unfortunately, against HIV. So anything we can do also to preserve the confidentiality of the disease is important for patients and their caregivers.
Okay, I'm very excited about some new formulation which has come up for children, and DNDi has contributed towards that. So could you please tell us something about a more child-friendly treatment for HIV?
Yes. Well, what we have developed together with our industrial partners, Cipla Limited, whose headquarters are in Mumbai. Cipla has a long-standing involvement in the treatment of HIV. If you remember, in 2001, Dr. Yusuf Hamid, the chairman of Cipla, made this historical announcement of saying, you know, we can provide HIV treatments for adults for less than $1 a day. This was a definite milestone in the treatment of HIV. It was a game changer that really revolutionized the landscape. So we're working with these very same teams at Cipla, and the challenge has been to develop a combination of drugs, a formula that includes the four drugs in a single presentation, in a very, very fine powder that you can mix with food or milk so that the baby does not even realize he or she is being treated, and which has no taste. And so this has been achieved after many, many years of work from Cipla, from the NDI, and now we have this fixed-dose formulation of four antiretrovirals, so which include the very well-known drugs lopinavir, ritonavir, abacavir, and lamivudine. So you have all the four drugs in a tiny little capsule, which the mothers can open and then pour the contents, this very fine powder, into food and or milk to give to children.
Okay. So this drug is in the market already, or it has been means it has been manufactured. So is it being sold now?
It is not yet being sold. We have submitted with our Cipla colleagues the registration file to the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, the FDA. FDA is reviewing the file at the moment. We expect to hear from them very soon to know if we stand a chance, as we hope, to be registered next year. So we hope that sometimes around, let's say, probably May to June 2020, if everything goes well, you know, we hope to be able to announce that this drug is now available. This would be a definite plus for patients, for their caregivers, because, you know, when you need to use a combination of drugs, if one of them is missing, then you just cannot treat people. So it's enough for one of the three or four drugs to be missing to be unable to treat people. So having four drugs in a single formulation is going to be a definite plus. Also, it gives us an opportunity, because the NDI was created by Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, to advocate for the care of neglected populations. It also gives us a very good reason to advocate for a better management of HIV in newborns, in young babies, and in their mothers. Because, you know, having us advocating for a problem doesn't bring you very far if you do not have a solution to offer. So having this solution to offer for the care of very young children gives us a seat at the table of people who say more needs to be done so that less and less children are infected with HIV. And those who are unfortunately infected with HIV need to be taken care of better. Because it's vitally important to try and stop the virus right from the beginning. If kids are not treated, 50% of them are going to die before the age of two. But even those who are, you know, who survive, need to be protected so that the virus doesn't cause irremediable damage to their bodies, to their brain, and so on. So if we want to have healthy adults, we need to deal with them very, very early on with adapted formulation. But this is what the NDI and Cipla have been developing.
Okay. And then you will have to get some validation from the WHO also after the FDA approval. Is that correct?
In fact, if FDA gives us approval, we will need to file a rather simple set of documents with WHO. Mm-hmm. Normally, the WHO pre-qualification should come very quickly after FDA approval. So we're going to work with WHO to understand what is the process to streamline the inscription, the presence of this formulation after FDA approval on the list of pre-qualified products. So normally the FDA registration should open up the door, if you will, for registration. But nevertheless, you know, we are also conscious that clinicians will want to have more data on this medicine. So we are in the process of developing or running a study in Uganda at the moment in HIV-infected children to look at the efficacy, safety, and acceptability of this medicine. So far, the first results we have in the first 16 children are extremely encouraging, both on the side of the pharmacokinetics of the drug, which is very comparable to the comparator products, the safety efficacy, but also very importantly, the acceptability by the mothers and the children. So we hope to be able to publish this data next year at the CROI convention in Boston.
Okay. And would there be more studies also conducted or what are you, outside of Uganda?
Yes, absolutely. We're also working on two specific sets of populations. The first one are the neonates. And so for this, we are contributing to a study run by Stellenbosch University in South Africa with CIPLA, with a financing from UNITAID, which has been granted very recently. So it's important for us to see if this drug can be used in neonates, because of course, these are tiny little babies, so we need to be sure that the drug behaves as it should. But also because we believe this drug might be useful to stop the virus in its tracks for kids who are exposed to HIV. You know, children who are exposed to the virus from their mothers but do not really have an infection. You know, this drug might, and we hope it could, be also a way to prevent infection. So it would be, you know, a preventive measure to avoid that the infection, you know, takes hold in the body of the baby. So neonates is one thing we are looking at. The other one we are going to look at also in South Africa is going to look at children who have a co-infection between tuberculosis and HIV. As you know, these two infections go hand in hand, unfortunately, many times. So we want to check whether any dose adjustment of the drug is needed when children also take a TB treatment.
Okay. So that is good news, and I just again want to sort of re-emphasize to our listeners that the current drugs which the children are taking are very unpalatable, first of all difficult to maintain at the temperature, particularly low and middle income countries. I had read somewhere that sometimes the mothers are burying the bottle in the sand to keep it cool, which is really disgraceful, keeping that children are being kept out, and maybe, I'm not sure, but maybe some parents may be just opting out of the treatment.
Of course, because you know, when people have got to walk for hours on end to go to the hospital or the pharmacy, yes, coming back carrying a very heavy load of bottles, you know, it's sometimes they may not be able to come back. Maybe some people need to spend a full day, you know, just to travel to the facility, wait for the drug to be dispensed, and come back. You know, it's sometimes hard to reconcile that with a work life or a family life. So indeed, the risk is that children's treatment is interrupted, and of course, in the meantime, the virus is going to flare up.
What is the price of, I'm curious to know, what is the price of the drug which is currently being given to children? What is the price of that?
The price of the current drugs is around, let's say, around 20 for these children. If we use the pellets, which are CIPLA's fixed dose formulation of lopinavir, ritonavir, plus the standalone drugs, the cost is around, let's say, $20 per month for children, or rather, yes, per course of treatment per month. Or I'm being a bit vague because it depends on the age range of the children.
Right.
So compared with that, CIPLA has taken the decision, which is very much in line with Dr. Yusuf Hamid's announcement in 2001, to price this new medicine at a humanitarian price of $15 a bottle. At $15 a bottle, prices the new drug at a level that is lower than the current treatments of the standalone drugs. And I think we need to be very grateful for CIPLA to take this initiative, because it shows clearly that they are not in this for the money. It's a humanitarian gesture. They act as a responsible company. This is not a market for them. They know it. It's a small and dwindling market. And nevertheless, you know, they went beyond the call of duty, if you will, by offering this price right from the beginning, before the drug is approved by FDA, as a way also to get people to move, and to it helps us a great deal in advocating for the children, to be able to announce such a commitment on the part of our industrial partner.
That is really great, but the next step now will be once the drug is approved, translating into action so that it reaches the people for and the kids for whom it is meant, because sometimes we have seen there is a lot of time gap between when the drug becomes available and when the countries put it in their own public health programs. So are there any processes around that, preparing people, as you said, Cipla has already announced that it will sell it at a reduced price. But then countries and programs should be prepared to introduce the new drug as soon as it is there.
Yes. So we are indeed preparing for this. Again, we need to be prudent. The drug is not yet approved by FDA, so we need to wait for this to happen. But nevertheless, we are planning for success because we know that time is of the essence, that these kids cannot wait. Mm-hmm. So we have mobilized lots of stakeholders. We are talking to many people. Now that the 4-in-1 appears to become a reality, people are incredibly helpful, incredibly mobilized to help us with this. We are fortunate to have the financial support of the AFD, the French aid agency, Agence Française de Développement. After that, of Unitaid, which has financed the full development of this drug very generously, in spite of all the ups and downs. We are very grateful for their continued support. So Unitaid has been incredibly generous. And so indeed, thanks to these funds that we are going to get from AFD, we are mobilizing people with the clear understanding that one size does not fit all. So we need to work country by country, identifying the people who are already existing to a large extent in the field of HIV, and mobilize them to specifically address the cause of young babies and their mothers. Because it's, as I said earlier, it's critically important not just to treat the babies, but also make sure that the mothers are properly treated, not only for their own health, but also for the health of the future babies, the little brothers and sisters to be born. And in that regard, because your channel is dedicated to communities, I think it's really important to enroll the help of the civil society everywhere in those countries, because quite logically, advocates speak up primarily for people who speak up themselves. So adults and adolescents have a voice, a prominent voice, and that's a very good thing. But no one speaks for babies. No one speaks for the mothers who have failed the prevention of mother-to-child transmission approaches. So these are truly neglected patients, neglected mothers, neglected babies, and we hope that the community organizations are going to help us advocate also for these very limited in number but very important for the future of the epidemic, these specific populations.
Okay. So that is important. And your message for ICASA 2019. You are leaving tonight also, yes. I heard, yes, so please, your message.
No, my message is that, leave no one behind. Do not leave the mothers who are infected with HIV transmit the virus when today it's so easy. It's so easy to stop the virus. And again, I would hate to use the term that has been used many times, but partnerships are the key. So we are very fortunate to have many committed partners, and again, having a solution to offer is a great way to help advocates do their work and make sure that we cut the epidemic at the root where we can.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Friends, in this episode of CNS Dialogues for Sustainable Development, we were listening to Francis Bompard. Again, I pronounced it incorrectly. He is the Director of Pediatric HIV and HCV at DNDi. And we are on site from the 20th International Conference on AIDS and Sexually Transmitted Infections in Africa, taking place in Kigali, Rwanda. Thank you very much, and stay tuned for the next episode.